In 1972, the musical group Funkadelic released one of my favorite songs, Biological Speculation. If you don't know the song, I want to share the beginning of the chorus with you. We're just a biological speculation, sitting here vibrating, and we don't know what we're vibrating about. Also in 1972 and 1973, researchers at Stanford and at San Francisco invented what became known as genetic engineering, the ability to take natural pieces of DNA and recombine them to make new chimeric molecules. Well, that's interesting. How would we, members of the clan of opposable thumbs who like to do things, apply this new tool if we don't know what we're vibrating about? 40 years have gone by, roughly. It's been a generation of genetic engineering. We've already heard today that it's been used. We've made foods. We've made medicines. We've made stuff. Recombinant insulin for treating diabetes. Engineered subtilisin for better laundry detergents to wash your clothes. And even better ice cream, those antifreeze proteins from fish that go in the ice cream so you don't get the big ice crystals in your low-fat ice cream. Isn't it funny that the that ice cream isn't marketed as Nemo Bits? Mommy, 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 I want some Nemo Bit ice cream. Oh, it's strange. You know, this technology, as we've explored it, we haven't always been comfortable with it. And there are good reasons for that. Maybe it's not safe. Maybe it disrupts the purity. Maybe it messes up the normative aspects of nature. Maybe it's just new. How could we do better? How could we start to talk in new ways about biotechnology? I don't know, and I've thought about that a lot. One of the things that I've had to confront is I'm not always sure how I make decisions and how I determine whether or not a choice I'm facing results in a good decision. And if I can't answer that question, it's very hard for me to consider any technology, especially living technology, and decide what to do with it. As best I can figure out, my wife and I, who's also a biotechnologist, we talk about this a lot, we've come up with a framework for thinking about whether or not we're making good decisions. And the way we've come up with this framework is to listen to nature, to return to nature, and to try and understand biology, actually. And what I mean by that, this will sound a little hokey and should sound a little bit abstract, but then I'll try and make it real for you. Biology, as I understand it, exists on an energy gradient. We're powered from the stars, from the sun, from the thermal vents, and living systems tap into this flux, this flow of energy, and are somehow able to do something incredible. They're able to make patterns that persist over time from one generation to the next. Very improbable patterns. If you were talking to a chemist about what a system should do, and thermodynamically speaking, it should just all blur away. But life is somehow capturing this energy gradient and making these improbable patterns that persist over time from one generation to the next. That's what it means to me to be alive, and if I believe that, then I can start to evaluate, am I making a good decision or a bad decision? What I want to be doing is I want to be alive. I want to be contributing to life. If I do something and it's more likely to lead to more improbability, more improbable patterns that continue to thrive and exist, and that was a good decision. Now, I'm not expecting all of you to be satisfied by that. That's just me being honest with you. Now, what does that have to do with making our civilization work, thinking about how to make decisions about advancing biotechnology? When I was biking in this morning to come over here, I was looking at the pine tree in the front yard of our house. We live over in Menlo Park. And it's that time of year where the pine tree is doing this. It's growing these objects. They're called pine cones. For the longest time, until about 2 years ago, I didn't think very much about my pine tree. It's not really mine. It's sort of in my front yard and whatever that means. But over the last couple years, I haven't been able to escape what's going on. In a few short weeks, the tree will grow hundreds, if not thousands, of these objects. They'll become quite big, like almost as big as a can of tennis balls. What do I do with this? Nothing. The winds come in the fall, falls off, gets swept up and composted. As I've looked into this, across the town of Menlo Park, the gardens and lawns of Menlo Park, we produce about 500 pounds per person per year of garden clippings in a town of 32,000 people. That's 16 million pounds of matter compiled from the atmosphere. This is actually a state-of-the-art nanotechnology. What could I do with it? Maybe I could change how we make things. Maybe I could I reprogram my pine tree to grow computer chips? Could this turn into something different? That sounds really improbable. Well, engineering is oftentimes about solving problems, but at a meta level, what engineering is also about is getting better at solving problems. And so in 2002, we set out to ask the question, could we make living matter fully engineerable? Could we make life programmable? Could I ever get to a future where I can grow computer chips in my front yard? It sounds impossible. But if you look back in time, engineers do get a lot better at doing things. 70 years ago, we weren't very good at engineering electrical computing systems. Several generations later, we're quite good at it. What should we aspire to get good at this century? We hear about the climate, we hear about loss of, so what should we do? Maybe we should get really good at engineering matter. And of course it will take us 70 years, but we better get started now. To work on that, I got support from DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, in 2002, and we didn't do any research, we just went and talked about how we would make engineering of biology easier. And by October of 2003, we had met a half dozen times with 50 of the smartest people we could find. I went and gave a briefing to the director of the federal agency. Mr. Director, here's the plan. Get a lot better at printing DNA from scratch, so people can become designers of biology and other people can become builders. Figure out how to abstract biological complexity, so that you don't have to program your DNA down at the machine level. DAATACGACTCACTATAGGAGA. Who can remember all that? And then develop standards to coordinate labor when we measure something. How do I share that measurement? Like the meter stick, but for inside a cell. And I gave that briefing in October of 2003, and it went over like a lead balloon. Why? It was a challenging time. The anthrax attacks had happened 2 years earlier. People were scared of biology, let alone getting better at engineering. If you have DNA printers, the garagistas working in their garages might print the genomes of viruses that'll be released and they'll have bioterrorists everywhere. Cut the funding, which is what happened. And so we had this weird environment of this idea of programming living matter could be really helpful. It could actually make things work, but also sounds really dangerous. Could make things not work at all. And it just kept going back and forth in the conversations politically. I call this the half pipe of doom. And the problem with the half pipe of doom is it consumes all the attention. And the much more interesting thing is to figure out what to do in the middle. It turns out the answer was to take it to the people. The artists, the designers, and the teenagers. We started something that's now called iGEM, the International Genetically Engineered Machines Competition. The first class of students was 16 students in 2003. This year, there are over 250 teams across 40 countries all over the planet where students will spend their summer designing and building living organisms to solve a problem wherever they are. They work well together because they're sharing the bits and pieces of DNA freely with each other. As this has progressed, institutions have returned. At Stanford, for example, we have a new department on campus, new in the sense of being 10 years old, but a new department, in this case called bioengineering, doesn't happen that often. The last time we started a department of that scale, it was called computer science. The building for the department will open next month. Can we do it? I think so. I probably won't be able to reprogram a pine tree in my lifetime, because it'll take too long. But I can probably reprogram a wood fungus that eats sawdust, that converts the sawdust into chitin as a type of plastic. I can bring into that organism a capacity from the oceans to do biomineralization, to make silica and metals. And if you give me 10 or 20 years, I bet I can change how we make things. But what's most important is it's not me making things, it's biology making things. It's already taken over the planet. We have a distributed manufacturing platform that's capable of putting atoms in precise positions. You can program it via DNA. The instructions for your DNA can be sent over the internet as information. The natural ecosystem is running on 90 terawatts of power, over four times what our civilization consumes. We are a biological speculation. What would you like us to be vibrating about? Thank you.